ऑफ ईसी थर्ड ईयर, शादन कॉलेज ऑफ इंस्टीट्यूट एंड टेक्नोलॉजी. टुडेज आवर स्पीकर पर्सन इज गोइंग टू स्पीक अबाउट मीडिया एंड साइंस पॉपुलराइजेशन, मीडिया, ब्लॉग, बुक्स, ट्रांसलेशंस. टुडे स्पीकर इज श्रीनिवास चक्रवर्ती सर. ही इज प्रोफेसर ऑफ कॉम्पिटेशनल न्यूरोसाइंस लैबोरेटरी, भूपाट एंड ज्योति मेहता स्कूल ऑफ बायोसाइंसेस, बिल्डिंग ऑफ इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी मद्रास. एजुकेशन न्यूरोसाइंस डिवीजन बायलर कॉलेज ऑफ, पोस्ट डॉक्टरेट ऑफ न्यूरोसाइंस डिवीजन बायलर कॉलेज ऑफ मेडिसिन ह्यूस्टन, पीएचडी इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियरिंग यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ टेक्सास ऑस्टिन, एमएस बायोमेडिकल इंजीनियरिंग यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ टेक्सास ऑस्टिन, बीटेक इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियरिंग इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी मद्रास. विजिटिंग रिसर्चर आरकेएन ब्रेन साइंस इंस्टीट्यूट, सॉफ्टवेयर इंजीनियर बेकर अटलास इंटरनेशनल हाउस्टन, पोस्ट डॉक्टरल एसोसिएट कंप्यूटेशनल न्यूरोबायोलॉजी लैबोरेटरी डिवीजन ऑफ न्यूरोसाइंस बायलर कॉलेज ऑफ मेडिसिन, रिसर्च असिस्टेंट लैबोरेटरी फॉर आर्टिफिशियल न्यूरो सिस्टम यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ टेक्सास ऑस्टिन, रिसर्च असिस्टेंट क्लमबर्गर लैबोरेटरी फॉर कंप्यूटर साइंस ऑस्टिन, एंड करेंट रिसर्च कंप्यूटेशनल न्यूरोसाइंस मॉडलिंग बेसल गैंग्लिया टू डेवलप एन इंटीग्रेटेड मॉडल ऑफ द बेसल गैंग्लिया दैट कुड एक्सप्लेन द मल्टीटियस फंक्शंस ऑफ दी स्ट्रक्चर्स विद इन द फ्रेमवर्क ऑफ रेनफोर्समेंट लर्निंग, मोटो न्यूरॉन रिक्वायरमेंट मॉडलिंग, मोटर न्यूरॉन रिक्वायरमेंट इज स्केलेटल मसल यूजिंग ऑसिलेटरी नेटवर्क्स, न्यूरोमोटर मॉडलिंग ऑफ हैंड राइटिंग, डेवलपिंग ए न्यूरोमस्कुलर मॉडल ऑफ हैंड राइटिंग जनरेशन इन्वॉल्विंग ऑसिलेटरी न्यूरल नेटवर्क्स.
This is hard from the user.
Excuse me, I think she's reading my entire resume. I think that's not necessary. Yeah, I think that should do. Shall we start the program? Dr. Elias?
Hello.
Yeah, shall we start the program? I think that's...
Yes, sir. I think, yeah, she's reading the full resume there. Okay, right, right. Yeah, please share, sir.
So I'll share in both the windows, right?
It's a privilege to invite Dr. Professor Srinivasa Chakravarti sir to our Shadhan College. We feel very happy to have you here, sir.
Thank you very much, Vikram. You have to unshare.
Our students going to motivate with your lecture, sir. Thank you for your precious time to take our classes webinar. Thank you, sir.
So Vikram, are we still using both the links?
Yeah, I'm seeing, sir. In my link it is.
Vikram, sir, we can continue, sir, with the lecture, sir.
No. Should we use both the links or one link is enough?
Both the links.
No, sir.
Which one? There is one where only you and me are there.
No, sir. You can use the other one where I am also there. So I am recording.
There are too many links now. So I'm confused now.
Okay. I'll ping you the link.
Okay.
I closed the thing. Okay. You can just continue in one of them. That's it.
That's enough.
Yeah, fine. And you can close other. Just BUG. Ending is BUG. That you keep it.
Okay, what about the other one? Should I add or
not? No need. Anyhow, it is going on YouTube live. Okay.
Oh, okay. So then it's fine. Right. So Sunday, I'm not joining the other one.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Okay, let me share my. Can you see my slides?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now you saw share to our.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Vikram. And thank you, Dr. Ilyas Mohammed, HOD ECE, Shahadan College of Engineering and Technology, for making for this invitation, kind invitation. So today I'll be talking about. It's a talk on motivation leadership, and which also includes career guidance for engineering students. The talk's title is "I Rise and I Help Others Rise." So the context of this talk is, as you know, for the last 2 years, we have been having a lot of trouble and difficult times due to COVID, which is happening all over the world. And sitting at home, there's a lot of depression, a lot of sadness also because of to live under these conditions. So I thought it would be good to talk about something that is motivating, talk to students about such things. So I began giving this talks, and Vikram has been kindly coordinating these events. So let me begin with a small situation that a lot of engineering students face in their final year. And at any point, if you are not clear about what I'm saying, please ask me. So generally, when you write your entrance exam, you get into some engineering college, and first years, just pass on very happily, and you'll be cruising through all the courses and all that. But come final year, there'll be some difficulty, because especially if you look at the JEE situation, I worked at IIT, and the JEE preparation typically starts when the student is in high school, on about 7th or 8th, and then for 3 years of intense coaching, and then get somehow get into IIT. So after that, first few years pass on merrily, and after that, they come to find you. Suddenly, you see a lot of students getting depressed. And if you ask them why is it like that, they may not say it in so many words, but usually the situation is a lot of pressure on them in the final year. That, as you answer, you're also facing it if you're in the final year. That's because there's a lot of expectation on these students right from the time when they first began their JEE coaching. Not only parents, not only siblings, but their friends and peers, neighbors, relatives. I mean, it's as though the entire society is interested in what wonders they're going to work after the GTEC. Right? So, and when the placements begin to happen and they don't get any job for some time, they get quite depressed and stress builds up. So, they have go through a lot of anxious times. So, for example, if they're applying to US for higher studies, they might be wondering, will I get good admission? Or if I don't get a job, what will other people say? Right? Will I get the job that I get, like the job of my dreams? So all these thoughts come to the mind, and there's a lot of anxiety about it. Right? Why is there so much anxiety? Okay, so one reason, especially in the way the life of a student
is that
typically we as students
make
that is our life, the student's life until that point.
Without discussing anything,
it's completely determined by somebody else.
Google they have very little choice on what they're doing
and how they're living.
So, take for example,
so once an IAS officer, a senior and a successful person, he brought his daughter to the JEE counselor. And so this girl got some rank, and for that rank, apparently she will get
pre-intimation, sir.
In IIT Madras. So this man came with a daughter and family. And
see, last 2-3 days, we are organizing.
And all
in between, he was asking,
so my daughter will get chemical in IIT Madras for her rank, and she will get chemical in IIT.
Okay, even if he
and something else in some other IIT, and
he should get is what
she will be doing. After that, she will be doing
MBA, and what she will be doing.
So the thing is, he was not even asking me anything. He was telling me what his plans are for his daughter. So I don't even know why.
Working under the limited, no?
No, and so it's like this father has decided the fate of the daughter for the coming 10 years. And throughout the entire session, this girl didn't open her mouth. She didn't have any questions. So then I asked her, what do you want to do? I mean, your father has all these plans for you, but what do you want to do? She just smiled and said, you know, she's fine with whatever her dad is planning for her. And this is a typical situation with a lot of children, because parents are so eager that the children should succeed and so on. So they set for the plan things for the children in great detail.
Shall we ask them to adjust the mic?
So what happens is, in life we need to have freedom. We need to have freedom to understand ourselves, to look into ourselves.
Sir, sorry for interruption, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, voice is little bit low, sir. Please adjust the mic. It will be good.
Yeah, yeah. Just 1 second. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
How about now? Is it better now?
Yes, sir. We can increase our volume, sir. Like in my system, increase my volume.
Okay, sir. Now it's better, sir. Now it's better.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So we need that freedom to explore and find out what our dreams are, try out various things, and sometimes even make mistakes, right? Learn from the mistakes. If you live like that, life will be more meaningful and there's some happiness. But if you completely live according to somebody else's dictates and according to somebody else's plans and dreams, then if things don't work out, you'll be depressed because you'll feel helpless, right? So why are we? Why does it happen? Why can't you know, every young person live like Superman? You just go wherever you want, you know, fly to the atmosphere, and so on. Why doesn't it happen? So there are a lot of reasons. You know, if you ask yourself, what is stopping you? There are a lot of reasons.
How many, sir? How many people are living?
So one reason could be somebody comes from a middle class.
How many views are there?
Not many opportunities. There is financial restrictions. Or somebody comes from a certain religion or caste, and therefore or somebody comes from backward region, like a small village, a very underdeveloped village. So therefore there's a problem. Or if it is a girl or a woman, you know, complain that this is a male dominated society and therefore there are not many opportunities. Or there's too much corruption in the society, in the government and so on, therefore there are, it's difficult for some people to, you know, climb up. Or there's another big complaint these days is that government is not creating enough jobs, right? So there are many reasons. Each person has a different reason. But if you look at it carefully and look at some examples, you find that these are not really reasons, but only excuses, right? For very often they're excuses for us not doing our part of our job. So if it is question of middle class family, look at the examples of Srinivas Ramanujan or Abdul Kalam, Jack Ma. They all come from really lower income families. Jack Ma, you know, this Chinese corporate giant. He's an English teacher in a small village, right, in China. So, or take the question of religion or caste. And Abdul Kalam, right, is one of the most admired and adored personality in India among Indian leaders. Right, and Ramnath Kovind, our current president. Or take the question of backwardness of the region. The Fogart sisters, you might have seen the movie Dangal, right, starring Amit Khan and the Fogart sisters. It's about this Palwan sisters, right, from a small village. Similarly, if you're talking about male-dominated society, I mean, look at these women, like, you know, Chanda Kochar, CEO of ICICI, or Arundhati Bhattacharya, CEO of SBI, and Indra Nui, CEO of PepsiCo. So they have all made it very big, in spite of, you know, living under very similar conditions. And so they have all reached great heights. Or if you're talking about corruption, I mean, take T.N. Session, right? He is also from a middle-class family. But single-handedly, he controlled corruption in the electoral commission. So, or if you have the, if you talk about connection, you know, some fields, you need to have connections, otherwise it's very hard to climb, right? That's the complaint. So, like, film industry is one example. So take the example of Ranveer Singh. Right? He doesn't have any connection. Right? He's just has risen through sheer talent. So this question of government not creating jobs. Let me give a counter example to that. Within the IIT system, because I know there are a lot of IIT system. There are more than 1,000 faculty jobs waiting. Okay, that's the only IIT system. So that in this case, the problem is not having enough jobs. But not having enough qualified people to fill those jobs. Okay, so for all these things, there's other sides to the story, and I think it's good to notice that. So if you want to have a great career, the first question we need to ask is, you know, not where there are jobs or what kind of jobs are there, what courses should I take. I mean, all that is also important, but the most important question is, what is your purpose in life? What do you want to do? What are your dreams? Right, and what is the why behind all your actions, and why do you do what you are doing? So very rarely we introspect and ask this question, put this question to ourselves. We always worry about the situation out there, but we hardly think about our own likings and dreams and so on. Right. So the first thing we need to ask ourselves, if you are thinking about a good career, is what is the your goal of life? Goal of life is not same for everybody. Somebody was saying, isn't goal of life just finding God? What is God? I mean, we don't even know what it is. So let us talk about something more concrete. What is your goal of life? Right. So we need to ask and begin with that question. So not only individuals, companies also have goals, and companies are founded based on certain key central goals. Like take the company that runs the TED Talks. I'm sure you all have seen TED Talks on YouTube. That the objective or motto of this company is to spread ideas, spread useful ideas in the areas of technology, education, and design. Right, and that's what they do. You know, they call eminent speakers in these fields, and make these lectures available to society. And that's a big hit. Similarly, Microsoft, the motto is to bring personal computer to every home. Right. There was a time when computers were so big, there were huge lumbering giants filling huge halls. Right, like the ENIAC computer you might have heard, which was built by the American government during Second World War. So, after that, the technology improved and they became much smaller and more compact, and they can sit on a desktop. Okay, so then Tesla, the company, the car company, the goal is to accelerate the world's transition to sustainable energy. So make electric cars more popular so that you stop using or so, decrease use of fossil fuels like petrol and diesel. So just as companies have motors and all their activities are organized around the central motor, and that's why they become so successful. Similarly, individuals whose activities, all life activities, are organized around a central motive can become very successful. They can come from any background, any poor background, doesn't matter. You see one pattern in their life. All their life activities are organized around a central theme. Look at this example of this boy, this 21-year-old boy, like somebody of your age, basically. So this boy, once he saw some trash in a river close to where he lived. And he felt bad about it, he cursed people who throw trash like that everywhere, irresponsibly. But we also see trash everywhere, but what do? We just, right, we'll be taking responsibility for ourselves. But otherwise, you cannot do anything about what others are doing, so we just leave it at that. But you know what this guy did? He's taken a small boat, a 20-foot boat, and he took both his hands and went out on the river and started clearing trash from the river, one by one, one bag at a time, one bottle at a time. But after working like that for a couple of days, he found that it's a very big task, much beyond his means, and he wanted to go and get some help. So this is the point where, whenever you try something significant, something is like to undertake a big project or a big problem, you'll find a dilemma, very soon. The dilemma is that, you have undertaken a big project, and it's way beyond your means. You don't have that means. To continue with it or give it up and then try something smaller. So this is where Sri Aurobindo is giving a very important suggestion. That is, if thy aim be great, thy means small, still act. For by action alone can these things accrue to thee. That is, if you have a big dream, a big project in mind, right, but you feel that your means is not sufficient, means is small, right, but still go ahead and do the act, get into action. Because by action alone can these things come to you. Okay? If you start acting, then slowly help will come to you. People will see your genuineness, right? The importance of your cause, and they can come to you and help you, offer help. Right? So, but if you don't even try, nothing will happen. So this boy went around, he first approached some government officials about and tried to make them aware of this problem. Everybody knows the problem, but nobody came forward to do anything about it. So he was turned down, he was rejected. So what did he do? Then he said, okay, government is no good, no point approaching government officials. He approached private companies. So how did he do that? He just took the phone telephone directory and he went to what's called the yellow pages. That's where the companies are listed, the telephone directory. So they are listed in alphabetical order. So he started calling up the companies one by one, starting with A. And he called some companies, some A star. Okay. So then he asked them, like, I need some money. They said, what for? So then he said, I have this river that's full of trash and I want to clean the trash. So I need some money. So they gave him some money. So it's some $8,000. So then he understood that it's not enough and he went to the next company. The next company is actually Anheuser-Busch. It's actually a beer company. So what does a beer company got to do with clearing trash in a river? Anyway, this boy didn't care about all that. He just went on knocking on doors. So this boy asked that official, company official, can you give me some money? The official said, who are you and what do you want the money for? He said, I want to clear the garbage in this river. Then he said, the company official said, you know, we have a proposal. This boy said, what's your proposal? Because this boy is not aware of anything. He doesn't know that if you approach a company for some funds, you have to give a proposal. That is, in a proposal, you first describe what is the objective, you know, why are you doing it, what is the motivation of this whole project, what is the methodology, and who is, how many people are required, what equipment is required, what is the budget. You have to describe all that in a proposal. He doesn't know anything of that. So then the company official sat with this boy because he saw that the boy is very genuine. He didn't think that he'll come and loot the company. So he sat with the boy, explained to him how to write a proposal, made him write the proposal, and then actually gave him some money. So like that, the boy went from door to door. I mean, he got a lot of rejects, I'm sure. Not every company helped. But he patiently went from door to door. And at the end of 8 years, he raised $2.5 million, right, and created a big organization and hired 4,000 people. And clean 1,000 miles of this river called Mississippi, it's in the US, right, and cleared millions of tons of trash. So it was a big hit, and his name is Chad Pregrate. The thing is, he comes from a lower income family, and he's not very rich, no connection, no nothing, right. All that he had is a very pure will, a pure intention. And he just followed up, did the action, whatever it takes, very patiently, very persistently. And he worked wonders. So that's what he says. You know, how do you change the world? If somebody asks him, he would say, all you have to do is change your world. That's how the world changes. So everybody has lots of complaints about the world. You know, this is not good, that is not good. You have so many things that you find are not good or not right about the world. So what do you do about it? Right, we have to do something about it. So that doing starts with that ourselves, with that person who is asking the question. And if you change your world slowly, and everybody does it, and the world changes. Let me give another example. This man is a professor at a university. He did PhD from US and then went back to his home country. So at that time in his home country, there was a lot of famine and there was a lot of starvation. People are dying. Lack of food, and it was situation was really like what you're seeing in that picture down there. So he was really upset about it, and because he is teaching economics in the university, and whereas outside people are so poor and dying for lack of food, and he found it is very ironical, quite absurd what he's doing for his profession and what's happening outside in the world. So he felt he should do something about the situation outside. So then one day he was walking on the street in a nearby village, and he saw this woman who was making stools, right, with bamboo. So she was making a few rupees every day, but she was caught in a debt trap, because to make that stool, she has to buy some bamboo and she has to take a loan for that. And these loans are offered at very large interest rates. And she makes very little money by selling that stool. And by the time she pays back the debt, she has very little left. Right, so she's constantly trapped in that debt, and she was living a very poor life. All that she needed was about 20 rupees to buy initial bamboo. So then this professor asked a student to go over the entire village and do a survey and find out how many people are there like that, you know, in that same situation. So he said there are 42 people, they're all hardworking and skilled people doing similar things. All that they needed is about 1,000 rupees to get going. So after that, they'll take care of themselves. That's the initial capital that all these guys wanted. The professor felt very bad because it's a small, very manageable sum, right? And it's very sad that even that kind of money, they're not able to raise for themselves. So the professor gave that money out of his pocket to the student and asked him to distribute it to all those poor people. And he said, tell them clearly that give it, we are giving it as a loan. It's not free. and they can repay it whenever they can, and they can sell their wares wherever they can. Right, so these people took it, and in the meantime, the professor approached the university bank of a branch seeking loans. He said, why don't you give loans instead of me giving money to these poor people, and my means are very limited. You are a bank, so you have a lot more money, so why don't you give loans to these poor people? The manager laughed and said, you must be crazy. I mean, how can you give loans to such poor people? They are not credit worthy. So then he was asked to approach higher authorities in the banking system, and he approached them, and every time they all said, no, it can't be done. We can't give loans to such poor people. Then the professor offered himself as a guarantor, right? And he said, okay, I will take care of it in case they fail to pay the loan, pay back the debt. So, but the thing is, every time these poor people, they have paid back the loans that they have taken. They never defaulted on their loans. So slowly, with his instrumental role, the banks began to give bigger and bigger loans to more and more people. And on every occasion, these people paid back the loans fully. So the experiment was extended to another village and another village. But still, the bankers won't. Still, they would hesitate to give loans to people without the intermediacy of this professor. So the success was repeated in more and more villages, in 10 villages, 50 villages, 100 villages. But in every occasion, they were able to pay back. But still, the bankers won't change their position. They're very stubborn. So then this professor had an idea. It's the only solution is to have a separate bank for the poor. Right, where they gave loans, even though these people don't have any credit worthiness or prior credit history. So that was resulted in the birth of the Grameen bank system. It serves 46,000 villages in Bangladesh. It has about 1,200 branches and 12,000 staff. It lent more than $4.5 billion. Loan values can be very small, $10, $12, things like that. Right, and this person, professor who did all this, was Muhammad Yunus. Right, he was Nobel Prize winner in 2006. So thing is, in these two examples, you see how successful people work. Right, all they start with, in both these cases, they are really lower income or middle income, people from that kind of a category. They don't have many connections. Because this professor, if he had connections, he would have just convinced the banking officials to give loans. So that didn't happen. It didn't happen like that. So both come from very humble backgrounds. All that they had is a pure intention. And they didn't do it overnight. They didn't work any miracles overnight. They kept on working on their dreams and kept on taking those small steps every single day. And slowly these small attempts added over a period of time, and they achieved something very big. Right? So you see that the manner of action or manner of living of the successful people, the very first thing they have is a pure intention, which is in form of a goal of life. Okay, so then what are the other qualities? So let us see that. The second quality of successful people that we will look at is proactive nature. They're all proactive. So what is proactive nature? Proactive behavior involves acting in advance of a future situation rather than just reacting to it. So very often you see people waking up after some problem has happened, after the situation has arisen. But whereas proactive people foresee a problem even long before it actually happens and take the necessary action. Okay, whereas a lot of people want to be spoon-fed throughout life. Somebody has to tell them, do this and do that, and then it'll be okay. Otherwise, they'll just be sleeping out. I had a friend, this guy works in US, but he has a lot of faith in astrology. So once he came to me to Chennai, and he went to some famous astrologers in Chennai and asked that person, where should I do the work, do my job, and whom should I marry, and etc. Because until he gets detailed instruction from somebody, he cannot take a single decision by himself. So a lot of people are like that. Somebody has to tell them what to do, otherwise they'll be completely clueless. Whereas the successful people, they're proactive. Not that everything that they do will succeed. No, that doesn't happen to anybody. Even the greatest people make a lot of mistakes. But thing is, they take that step forward all by themselves and take that action. So that is proactive nature. So being proactive, right? The opposite of this of it is being a slave of the environment, right? If you don't have any will of your own, 10 people tell you 10 different things, and you'll simply be obeying the wills of everybody around you, which can be quite scary. So in fact, in neuroscience, there is a disorder, there's a brain disorder, where the patients exactly behave like that. So this French doctor called François Hermy had patients who were literally slaves to the sensory world. That means they just obey the stimuli coming from the world around them. Suppose you give them a toothbrush, they just take it and immediately start brushing their teeth. Or if you give them a pen, they immediately start writing something, on the paper with that pen. Or if you give them a comb, they'll immediately start combing themselves with that comb. Thing is, they don't even understand whether it's relevant to that context or that moment or not. So such a disease is called environment dependency syndrome. It happens in some patients where there's a damage to a part of the brain called prefrontal cortex. It's in the front of the brain. So what happens in this patient, and so that's a really a difficult brain disorder. But a lot of people, even though people who are considered normal, also behave like that. That is, they're completely slaves of stimuli coming from the world. Right? If there's stimulus, they'll respond to it mechanically, like almost like a robot. Right? There is. Whereas in successful people, right, in normal people, right, between stimulus and response, there is a conscious will. Right? Will decides what your decision is, and then they respond. They're not constantly only responding to stimulus. They have their own will with which they take action. That is proactive behavior. But two things can decide your response, stimulus and will. Right? If will is more dominant in deciding your response, then you're proactive mind. Let me give another example of an excellent example of proactive mind. This boy called Afroz Shah, he's a lawyer in Mumbai. So young lawyer. So once he was staying in a hotel on the seaside close to Mumbai, right in near Vasava Beach. So he had a sea-facing room and he was enjoying the view and the breeze and all that. Suddenly he saw something interesting on the seashore. He saw a white long road, like a path, right off the seashore. He started wondering, what is that road? Because normally the asphalt road is black or dark gray. But what is this white road, sitting on the road on the seaside? So he was curious and he came down and went close to the water, and then he was shocked to see what he saw. It's not a road, it's actually a huge pile of trash, right, all along the, it made the entire, the shoreline so ugly. So he started inquiring around and find out what has led to this, who has done this, right, and nobody bothered because, I don't know, the municipality must be dumping trash there for a long time, and nobody bothered. So he said that he was very sad about it, and he tried to approach the municipal officials, and nobody bothered. Then he just called a few friends, and they started literally clearing the trash. But they began doing that, and so the other people also joined. And after a period, that group or the movement that was initiated by this boy, Afroz Shah, right, that group was able to clear 9 million kgs of trash. From then they completely cleaned the beach, and now it is very pretty. So that was almost like a miracle. And so this reporter who heard about this miracle came to interview Afroz Shah. And the first question the reporter asked him is, why did you do it? Because you're not a politician, you're not a political leader. You're not a municipality official, right? You're just an ordinary citizen of India. Why did you do it? Then this boy asked, if not me, then who? And if I don't do it, and who will do it? If everybody thinks it's somebody else's problem, the problem will never get solved, right? Somebody has to take the proactive first step. So that is a classic characteristic of a successful person. So taking 100% responsibility for one's own fate and future. This is the first quality of successful people. People who are basically failures, they always blame it on somebody else. And there's always an excuse because of something, somebody, and like this. But successful people, first thing that they do is take responsibility for themselves. And that initiates a growth process. The third quality, they don't wait for opportunities, right? They create them. Very often you see people asking the question, that is, I want to do something, where are their opportunities? So opportunities are there wherever you make them, right? They don't wait for you just like that. Okay, so let me take the example of this other girl called Jana Stanford. Right, this girl is a singer. She wanted to be a singer, and right from her youth, you know, she was very fond of singing. And she took some training also in singing. So initially, she did some singing jobs in a local hotel. Right, that went on for some time. But later on, her ambitions grew, and she wanted to become a lyric writer and also a recording artist. So she went to a nearby city, in a city called Nashville, which is in the state of Tennessee in the U.S. It's a big city, and the city is known for it's considered a music hub in the U.S. So a lot of talented young musicians like her, they go to that city and look for opportunities. She tried to get a recording opportunity for 3 years, and nothing worked out. But she was a bit quite disappointed. So she didn't know what else to do. So she hit a roadblock, right? Her life hit a deadline. She didn't know what else to do. So that's when she takes an important decision. She recognizes a very important rule of life, which is that if you want to, whatever you want to become, you become that inside first. It then becomes a reality outside. That is, so in this case, this girl, she wants to become a singer. So she was looking for some kind of a job in a music company. That didn't work out. So then she decided, since I'm a singer, I'll just keep singing. Why do I need a job for singing? And even if I don't have an official job, I'm still a singer. So then with that thinking, she stopped looking for opportunity. She just began to create her own opportunity and began to sing wherever she can. If she goes to attend a party in somebody's home, if somebody asks her, going to sing, she would sing. Or she would go to schools nearby and sing and entertain and motivate children. Right? Or if she would just go sing on the streets. Right? You see very often people sing on the streets, and you think it's something that's below your dignity. But if that's what you like and that's what you are, there's no harm in doing it. Right? And people like your singing, they appreciate you. So she began singing like that everywhere and wherever she can, and she began to write her own songs, set music, her own music to those songs. So she's basically talented, and began to sing in even some churches. She got a lot of response from people, and once this one old woman, she approached this girl and said, look, I really like the song that you sang sometime before, and whenever I think of that song, tears come to my eyes. It was a very moving song. Can you please record it for me on a cassette tape and do it so that I can listen to it over and over again? So then this girl recorded that song and also a bunch of songs on a cassette tape and made many copies of the cassette tape. And she began selling them. Okay, she and her husband also helped her a lot in this effort. So they both of them started recording this girl's songs and began selling them. Slowly, she worked her way up, step by step like that, over a few years. And after a few years, she started two companies of her own. One is called Keynote Concerts, other is called Relatively Famous Records. This Keynote Concerts offers motivational and musical programs in colleges. They conduct about 50 concerts every year, and very successful. It's a big hit with colleges and younger people. So even the Relatively Famous Records offered a chance right at livelihood for a lot of young talented singers. So this is a great example of people. Of the motto, I rise and I help others rise. So she looked for a job and nothing worked out, but she had faith in herself. She had a lot of self-belief. She kept on working on her dream, and not only she went to a height, reached a height, she also helped a bunch of others like her to reach a height. So the next quality is they're action-oriented. They're not mere talkers. They're action-oriented. They like to get into action very quickly. So let me give a small example of this action-oriented behavior. This is Ashok and Renu. So they began their internship. So let's say both of them are in their third year of engineering. So Renu started preparing her resume, and she started designing it with great care in terms of choice of fonts and all that stuff. So she spent a long time touching up her resume. Well, Ashok, he doesn't have patience with, you know, making a great resume. He just made something approximate, something reasonably good, and started actually contacting companies and, you know, calling them up and sending mails and so on. Within a week, Ashok landed an internship position where Renu is still preparing her resume. So point is, action-oriented behavior can give us results quicker, faster. So now when we talk about action, like, we need to distinguish between two things. Because when it comes to the domain of action, where do we direct our action? Where do we not direct our action? So in this regard, people talk about two circles. So one is called the circle of influence. The other is the circle of concern. Like, what are the circles? You know, let me explain that using a small joke. So once this couple were awarded, like the best couple, they got this best couple award. They're known to be very harmonious and very happy couple. So once the TV interviewer came to interview them to find out what is the secret of their marital success. So the interviewer asked them, like, how did you achieve it? How are you able to live so harmoniously? Whereas couples keep fighting. So how did you do that? So the wife first explained, look, right from the beginning, soon after marriage, decided that we should clearly demarcate our domains of action. That is, each of us work in different domains, and either of them will stick their finger in the domains of the other person. Then they sort of harm you. The interviewer was quite surprised. That's not very easy. Right? When you're living in the same home, how can you demarcate your domains like that? So then the interviewer asked, what are those domains? And the wife explained, when it comes to what to buy for the home, or what school the kids should go to, or what tuition they should go to, all these domestic decisions are my domain. Then the interviewer is even more surprised. Then what is the husband going to do? Right? She said, laughing, my husband takes care of America's foreign policy, India's economic strategy, China's then Australia trade problem. So the biggest problems of the world, that's the I think it's kind of new to somebody has to unmute. Hello. Can you please mute yourself?
Okay, koi bhi nahi sunta.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, so these biggest questions of the world are the preoccupation of the husband. Right? So basically, she is saying that his husband is a useless fellow, doesn't do anything. Whereas all the domestic decisions are taken by the wife. Therefore, we don't have any conflict of decisions. The wife explained, smile. So this is just an illustration, just a joke, right? To say that, you know, what are these two, to explain what are the two circles of concern, the two circles. Right, the circle of influence means the circle where if you do something, there will be an effect. You can have an influence there. Right, the circle of concern means you have a lot of concern, but you cannot do much in that domain. Take the example of COVID right now. A lot of bad things are happening all over the world, but you and me cannot do anything about it, right? But what we all can do is take care of the situation in our own families, right? We can make sure that people are wearing their masks, people are sanitizing their hands, and, you know, maintaining social distance, etc. If you are a doctor or something, you can do something more. But otherwise, this is what we can do. So our focus should be completely in the circle of influence, where whatever we do will have an effect. And the circle of concern is not much you can do, so leave it, don't waste your time there. And if you live like that, if you keep on working like that on your circle of influence, that influence will grow over a period of time, over the years, and you'll be able to have even greater effect, right, on the society around you. So it's a very important truth that we very often ignore this truth. Okay, so the next quality of successful people is that, so when we talk about goal, very often you may not know what your goal is. You may not know what is your real passion is. You have to try out a couple of things before you finally decide on one real passion. So you need to explore many paths, and finally, when you find that real thing, what you really like, you should pursue it relentlessly without any let up. So let me give another example of a successful person like that. This guy called Dan Brown is an eminent author. He's written lots of novels, very successful novels. His books have been translated into 57 languages. And as of 2012, his books have sold over 200 million copies, that is 20 crore copies. And it's a phenomenally high, big number. The thing is, this guy did not want to be an author to begin with. His ideas were, plans were something else. In the beginning, he was interested in music and he was producing children's music. He even started a company called Dalliance, where the company produces children's music. But nothing much happened. He didn't have much luck in that. Later on, he went to Hollywood to try his hand as a singer and lyric writer. Right there also not much luck, but that's where he met his life partner, who was very good at PR and at personal relationships. So this woman, his wife, projected him very well in the Hollywood circles, right? And he tried to become a successful singer and a lyric writer, but that never worked. He tried that for a few years, and he started having second thoughts, right? So there's no point keep on trying the same thing when it is not working. You should try something else. So, but what is that something else? In 1993, this guy and his wife went on a vacation to some seaside, some seaside resort. There, one day he was, sitting in the beach and reading a novel, a Sidney Sheldon's novel called Doomsday Conspiracy. But he really enjoyed that novel. That's when he got inspiration about what he has to do now. He said, why don't I start writing novels? Because novels are great, novels are very exciting. And this guy is good at English. He had an English literature kind of degree. So that's when he started writing novels and he became big. Okay, so your very first attempt at something may not be a successful enterprise. But that doesn't mean you have to stop, you have to quit. You keep trying several avenues before you find your real passion. Okay, so the next quality of these people is they are constant learners. So they keep on upgrading their knowledge all the time. So that can be in the form of books, they can be motivational books or informational books, right? And coursework, you can take your courses in your college or take online courses to supplement what you learn in your college. You can go for internships, right? National, international, because of the COVID, since everything is online, it's very easy to get international internships. All that you have to do is you should be persistent. Even if, you should knock on many doors before you get an opportunity. Then lectures, direct lectures, internet lectures, whatever it is. So meeting people, finding out, learning from people, talking to people, etc., etc. The thing is, upgrading knowledge is very important, especially in the current century, right? If you want to have a great career. You should have this habit of constantly expanding your knowledge and updating your knowledge. Because that's the nature of the economies all over the world these days. If you look at 19th century world, at that time, the economies were industrialized economies. So the economy depended upon having access to machines. If you are in possession of great machines, then you can create wealth. It was the machines that were creating wealth. Whereas in the later half of the 20th century, right, the economy started making a transition to knowledge-based economies. So in this new economy, knowledge is the most precious thing. Right? Therefore, whoever has knowledge, they become valuable. That's why if you look at the economy these days, one of the most precious thing is intellectual property, IP. That people go to great lengths to secure IP, to protect IP, and so on, to get IP. Because knowledge is more precious now than even gold and silver and cash and all. Because this is what translates into money later. So in this context, I would like to quote a quotation from Peter Drucker, who is considered the father of modern management theory. He said, in the future, there will be no poor countries. There will be only ignorant countries. Right. What he means is, if a country is ignorant, the country will be poor. So the same thing applies to individuals also. If we are ignorant, we'll also be poor. Right. So in Telugu, you can make it as a formula. Telimi, which means ignorance, leads to lemi, which is poverty. Right. So you can upgrade your knowledge to a lot of books. I also recommend a lot of motivational books, not just your engineering books. So I personally like this book a lot, Jack Canfield, The Success Principles. He talks about 64 qualities of success, right? And it's a very nice reading. He gives lots of examples of case studies, individual stories of successful people. It's very motivating. Another book I can recommend is The Seven Habits of Effective People by Stephen Covey. This book is very popular world over, and you know, it was 330 million copies of this book were sold and also translated into many, many world languages. Then Rashmi Bansal is an IIM graduate, and she also has written a lot of books on Indian entrepreneurs, people who have succeeded in various domains in India. Has a very nice series of books. Then The Magic of Thinking Big by David Schwartz. In this book, he says that, you know, in your career, always try to have big ideas, right? That means you need to learn a lot before you come up with a big idea. But the thing is, once you have a big idea, the big ideas have their own power of attraction. They attract help, they attract attention. We have a big idea. So in that regard, I'll give an example of this person, an architect called Daniel Bonham, right? He was the person who designed the modern city of Chicago. This was in the late 19th century, right? Before that, the American cities were very badly designed, a lot of congestion on the streets, a lot of dirt on the streets, and it was chaotic, like, you know, a lot of Indian towns and cities. But with this guy, you know, he's one of the new generation of architects who designed more modernized plans for American cities. So he has written even a book on his plans for Chicago. He says in that book, make no little plans. They have no magic to stir men's blood. Make big plans, for a noble document once recorded will never die. So he says, make big documents and put it in writing. Give it a written form. Write about it. Write, document it. And once a big plan is written, big idea is written down, you know, it will have a long life, it will never die. So a lot of books like that, so Making India Work, read by William Nanda Bissell. William Nanda Bissell is the CEO of Fab India. Right, this book here is almost like a thesis. This book came almost, I think, 10 years ago. He writes how you can fix Indian government system and make it more efficient. And so there's another famous book called Cosmos by American writer called Carl Sagan, right? And this book is brilliant. I think every young person should read this book. I've translated it into Telugu, and if you can read Telugu, you can get the Telugu version also. Right, so there are millions of books. I just gave like a handful of titles. But try to get into this habit of reading motivational books. And they can completely change your life. I've given a few titles. If you want more titles, I can send you a list of more titles. I myself have about 200-300 books in this genre, in the motivation, leadership, all that. They're very, very motivating, very helpful. So please take a look at some of these books. Then the next quality is they're risk takers. The thing is, very often in life, we are used to living in certain comfort zone. That as long as we live in that zone, life will be going on smoothly and not much trouble, but not much progress either, right, as long as we live in the comfort zone. So whereas if you want to go to the next level in life, then you have to get out of the comfort zone, do something more radical, you know, take a leap, and maybe even necessary to take risk. So for that, let me give an example of this guy called Jeff Ark. So this guy is a school teacher. He teaches karate in a school, but to small children. He was doing that for many years, and at some point he got bored of his job. Because every day he would go to school and teach the small children karate. And teaching karate to small children is not very challenging. It's a very simple kind of a job. He was getting bored with his life. So then he began to listen to these motivational tapes by a motivational speaker called Tony Robbins. In one of those tapes, Tony Robbins says, you have to dream bigger. Right, he says you should not settle down at wherever you are right now in your life. You should try to go to next level and dream bigger and make an effort to go to next level. So that set this guy thinking. So this man always wanted to make a movie. Right? Actually, he wanted to write a story for a movie and help creation of that, help that idea get realized. So he sat down and wrote a script for a movie called Sleepless in Seattle. He showed the script around to some of his friends to ask their opinion. They all said it is bad and it won't succeed, don't bother. Why is that? Because in this story, the hero and heroine don't meet until about half the movie. Right? So the friends said, you know, like, you know, only in story, in the movies, hero and heroine meet right in the beginning, and they're doing something all along, especially if you look at Indian movies. Hiran kept singing songs all through the movie, and even then, films flop, right? So if that is the case, then how can a movie where the hero heroine don't meet after half the movie, how will it succeed? That's what his friend said. But Jeff was not convinced. He kept asking people, then he kept approaching people in the film industry and kept showing them the story. And finally, somebody liked the story, and this guy was able to sell the story for about $250,000. Subsequently, the story was made into film, and it became a huge hit. There was even Oscar nomination for Jeff for screenplay. And even the actors who played the lead roles, Tom Hanks and Meg Ryan, that really catapulted their career as actors. This movie really worked well for them. So taking a risk like that can really take you to the next level. You need to do that if you really want a huge progress in your life. Okay, next thing, they learn from mistakes. Like I said, whenever you try something out of the way, there's very high likelihood of failure. But that doesn't mean you should completely get disappointed and demoralized and stop all effort. So there are ways of taking this feedback from the world in the form of failure. That is, you can get demoralized, you can get upset, you can completely stop working after that. But that's no good. That won't. Because this feedback that you get, right when you make an attempt and failure, you can see if there's any meaning in that feedback, any truth in that feedback. Like somebody, you write a book and somebody says it's bad, or you show a product and somebody says it's bad. So you can, instead of getting upset about it, can you study it and see if there's any truth in it? Check with facts, ask 2-3 people. If 2 people, 3 people, 4 people, they all say it is bad, maybe they're right. Right, so then we have to go back and redesign the product or rewrite the book or something like that. Right, so take corrective action, because what is fail? Fail means first attempt in learning. That's how you learn, by failing, by doing something and failing. Nobody escapes that process. So be prepared for failures and learn from failures. Then the another important quality that successful people have is they're willing to walk the extra mile. Okay, I'll give you a simple example to illustrate this. So this incident happened in a Pittsburgh departmental store or a shopping mall. So once in the shopping mall, it was raining outside and not many customers in the shopping mall. And at that time, an old woman walked into the shop. There were a bunch of salesmen, but they were all sitting in a corner and chatting among themselves. Nobody noticed this woman. But one salesman sees this woman and approaches her and asks her if she would like to see any products. Then this lady said, no, because it was raining, I just came in. I'll just wait here until the rain subsides and then I'll go away, don't bother. Then this man said, no problem, lady, madam, just and then he offers her a seat, and she asks her if you want, should I get you some coffee or tea, and because it's cold outside. He says, no, there's no problem, you just manage, you just go off with your own activity and I'll be fine. So that incident ends there, and after a few weeks, this boy gets a letter in his mail. The letter is an offer letter of a job to this guy. Okay, so this offer was for this guy to start a new shopping mall, which is about to get opened in Scotland. So then this guy is completely surprised, because he is a very small and ordinary salesman. How did he get such a big job offer? It turns out that the woman who came to the shop was the mother of a big American industrialist called Andrew Carnegie. And so she saw this boy's nature of going out of the way to help people and to get his job done. Right? So he recommended this boy's name to his son, Andrew Carnegie, and this man made the job up. So very often, so what happens is when you do a job, the job has certain job duties, job definition, that you should do X, Y, Z as a part of your job duties. But very often, right, to get the job done, you may have to go out of the way and do certain things, right? Of course, make sure it's only legal, right? So in this case, for example, as a salesman, his job is just to show products to customers and there ends the matter. But make sure they get sold. His job is to sell. He's a salesman. But because the person who came into the shop at that time is an older woman, and out of concern for her, and he made her feel comfortable. This first thing that you have to do with the customer, make them feel comfortable, make them feel welcome in the shop. Very often you don't see that. So salespeople will be talking among themselves, they don't even notice customers when they come into the shop. So he did all that, and that is what is called going the extra mile, right? Walking that extra mile. So when this woman saw that quality in this boy, she said, you know, this guy's good material, that he can do successful, he can work successfully. So he recommended his name to her son, and the son gave him this job offer. So next quality is not to be dejected by rejection. So whenever you attempt anything, like I said, that there'll be failure, there'll be rejection. It's very common, right? And it's common to everybody, even the most successful cases, right? But
Just a minute. Yeah. Sir, can you share your screen in the other one also? Because people are joining actually. For, please share, okay? It will end with IPT. Okay. IPT. The link will end with IPT. You are already there, only share the screen. Yeah.
Okay, got it.
Yeah. Actually, I've been asking, so I told them to see YouTube live, but yeah. Okay, right, fine, good. Thanks,
sir. Yeah, okay.
Fine, thanks.
Yeah, thanks. So, this guy, his name is Sylvester Stallone. He says, I take rejection as someone blowing a bugle in my ear to wake me up and get going rather than retreat. It's like whenever somebody rejects him, it's like for him, it's like somebody is blowing a trumpet in his ear, right? So that will really wake him up and charge him up and electrify him to, you know, to go forth and work even harder and do even better. So he, this guy is a famous actor, director, and writer. And so that's a position he has taken towards rejection. Rejection doesn't stop him, it'll actually accelerate him. It will motivate him even more to do even better. So another example is John Creasy, who is a British mystery writer. So this guy wrote lots of books. He wrote 600 books over 40 years under different names. But thing is, before he wrote so many books, he received 743 rejections. That is, initial manuscripts were rejected repeatedly over and over and over again, 743 rejections. That's a lot of rejections. And not many can withstand so much rejection in life. But this guy did it, right? And he's become such a big writer after that. So thing is, rejection occurs to everybody, but thing is, a lot of people quit after a few rejections. It's a small number of people who don't quit, right? Who keep on going forward in spite of rejection. These are the ones who end up being successful. Another very nice example, right, of a little boy who refused to take no for an answer. So this boy, now he's a man, but his name is Monty Roberts. When he was a small boy in his school, once his teacher gave him an essay to write. The essay, topic of the essay is, what do you want to become when you grow up? So it's this kind of essays we all must have written in our school. So this little boy wrote that he wants to become he wants to own a huge ranch of about 200 acres. He had very clear ideas even at that age. He wanted to buy a ranch of 200 acres, and he wanted to groom or race horses in that ranch and sell these horses and become very rich. He had a very precise idea about what he wants to become, even at that age. Then the teacher gives him an F grade, a fail grade for that essay. And why is that? He just says, you are being very unrealistic. And look at your current situation, look at your dreams. There's no match. Right? Because this boy comes from a very poor family, and the entire family lives in a very small hut. So this is too big a dream for him at his current stage. So the teacher says, no, be realistic and I'm going to fail you in this essay. But the teacher asks him to come back again and says, if you rewrite your essay in more realistic terms, I'll change your grade. I'll give you some pass grade. And you know what the boy says? Thank you, my dear teacher. You keep your upgrade, I'll keep my dream. Right? So the thing is, he doesn't want to have a silly, simple, so-called realistic dream. He wanted to keep his dream. He wanted to stick with that grand dream. And ultimately, he realizes that the dream. He actually, once he becomes older, right, he successfully buys a huge ranch of about 150 acres, and it's called the Flagisup Farms. and he grooms race horses on that ranch, and he sells them. A really rich guy, right? Whatever he dreamt as a small boy in school, he realized a dream, right? And the rejection from the teacher didn't stop him. Okay, they finally they pursue their goal for long years, right? So thing is, this kinds of dreams are not realized in one day or one night, right? That you have to stick with that dream for a long time, for many years before you realize that kind of a dream. So how long? Okay, regarding that question, this noted writer called Malcolm Gladwell. This guy wrote lots of successful books. You can take a look at some of his books, like for example, Outlier and Tipping Point and Blink and so on. In one of these books, he says, in fact, researchers have settled on what they believe is a magic number for true expertise: 10,000 hours. What does this mean? So if you want to become an expert at any skill, you have to put in something like 10,000 hours of practice into that skill. Right? Only then you can be considered a real expert. And a lot of top people, because people think that, you know, talented people don't need any practice. They are like gods. They just straight away go and perform. It doesn't happen that way. Even the most talented, most successful people put in, you know, hundreds and thousands of hours, right, practicing their craft. So 10,000 hours seems to be like a minimum that is required. So let me give an example of somebody who becomes successful by working on his dream for many years. So this man's name is Anand Negi. He's called the Desert Healer. So this guy used to work in Himachal Pradesh state government as a part of this, what is called Desert Development Program. So the objective of this program is to convert some of the desert areas of Himachal Pradesh into, you know, green and fertile regions. So Himachal Pradesh being a mountainous region, a lot of dry and, you know, desert land. And this team used to go to a place called Kinnaur and try to work on changing it. But over a period of time, what this man noticed is the state government keeps on spending money, blowing up money on these activities, but nothing is happening. So at some point, he began to work on it by himself, independently, outside the government program. So he began his work on a personal basis from 1999. And after working on it for a few years, in 2003, he completely gave up his government job and moved to Kinnaur and started continuing the work. And a few people, the locals, helped him in this effort. And after about, 10 years of effort like that, this small group transformed about 20 hectares of mountainous desert land and completely made it green. How did they do it? By planting 30,000 trees. It's all just a small group. There's no government funding, nothing. Right? So the thing is, people can work miracles if they have that pure intention and keep working on that dream for a long time. Okay, so let us take a short break now. I mean, until now, I talked about the qualities, the individual qualities of successful people. But nobody can earn success just by working all by themselves. You have to work as a group. You have to work with others. Right? So now let us talk about how to work with others to become successful. Just let's take a two-minute break.
The talk will be there for half an hour more. Please be ready with your questions. Just after sir concludes, you can start asking questions, okay? Approximately half an hour more.
Okay. Yeah, hi. So let us continue our discussion. So let us talk about how to work with others. So when we talk about others, I'll divide these others into three categories. People who are above us, who are older than us and wiser and more competent, more successful than us. and who can give us advice and counsel, right, and can motivate us, can guide us. We can call them mentors, right? This is first category of people. And second category is people who are at the same level of us, our peers, our equals. The third category is, you know, somebody who is more junior to us. So let us talk about the first category. These are mentors, right, whose guidance to us can be really helpful. And these people can have concern for us, right? We have admiration for them. And you can call them guru, you can call them mentor or teacher, whatever it is. So some examples, you can talk about Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda, like a great teacher and a great disciple. Right, that's in world of spirituality. But if you look at, let's say, world of sports, a great example is Pulalu Gopichand and P.V. Sindhu. And so that you see that a lot of successful people have great mentors in their lives, right? And that initial input, initial mentoring, initial guidance can push them and guide them all through their lives and their careers. So one has to look for a mentor like that. Even your college, see if any of your teachers, right, are more approachable and talk to them, explain to them about your dreams and, you know, ask them for guidance, right? Build a rapport with them so that their guidance can be of constant help to you in your career efforts. In the second category of people are more like people at your level, like your equals, right? It's always important to form a group of like-minded people, right, who have shared goals, have similar interests, similar mindset. And they're all, they should be progressive. They all want to do something good in life, right? Not just waste time, while away time. And some writers call such a group a mastermind group, and very often successful people have that kind of a mastermind group. And in within this group, everybody helps and motivates other people, the other members of the group, right? And whenever you have doubt, you're facing a challenge or a crisis, you can approach others in that group and ask for guidance, ask for motivation, inspiration, and so on and so forth. So in this group, make sure you don't include people who are very pessimistic, people who are negative, toxic, people who think that nothing is going to change, right? That kind of people can bring down the whole group. So make sure you don't have that kind of people in the group. To give some examples, it's important to have that kind of group because, to quote Helen Keller's quotation here, alone we can do so little, together we can do so much. So it's important to have that kind of a small group, right? And so then it will be easier to progress. So a great example of that kind is the founders of Infosys. It was started by 7 people initially. So all these people were colleagues in a company. They used to work in a company called Patni. So then at some point they said they should start their own company. So they got out of Patni and started their own company in Infosys. Apparently, you can see Narayan Murthy and Chris Gopal Krishna in this picture. Apparently, Narayan Murthy's wife, Sudha Murthy, gave some initial financial support. And they started an office in the front room in their house. And from that point, you see where they have come to. So one of the biggest corporate giants in the country and the multinational. Another example of that kind of a mastermind group, that is a bunch of young boys. This story is actually happened. This story happened in a small village in US. This village is called Colwood. It's a small village in a state called West Virginia. The story happened in 1958. So at that time, Russia just launched a satellite, an artificial satellite called Sputnik. You might have heard of it. That was the first artificial satellite. And the specialty of Sputnik is you can see it from the Earth, especially at night time on a clear sky. You will see Sputnik as a small moving bright dot. It will look like a moving star. That's because of the arrangement of its solar panels. So all over the world, people began to see this wonder, and you know, it's a man-made wonder, and they began commenting on it and thinking about it. So in this village also, all the villagers came out of their homes one night and to watch this wonder. And the villagers were commenting in various ways, looking at this moving star. Some people were scared that because Russia now can throw bombs on them by launching rockets, right? If you can put an artificial object in the sky like that, which can travel all around the earth, and that's potentially very dangerous because that can be used to throw bombs on other countries. So people were a bit scared. So among those spectators, there was also this bunch of five schoolboys, right? And they were all looking at that satellite. And suddenly one of those boys, his name is Homer. Homer is the name of a famous Greek poet. This boy suddenly made a decision. I'm going to build a rocket, right? The thing is, it's such a backward village. There was nothing in the village at that time other than a coal mine. In fact, American space program has hardly started in the 50s, right? So it's a really bold decision to want to build a rocket at that time. So then this boy started wondering, how do you build a rocket? How do you, what does a rocket even look like? So then nobody in the village knew anything. Even there's a village school, but nobody in the school knew anything about a rocket. So these boys wrote a letter to a scientist who was working in NASA at that time to help them build a small rocket. So the scientist wrote back to them and gave some material, some literature. So this boy started making some little project rockets, toy rockets in their backyard. And every attempt of them and ended in a failure. So they would make a rocket and it would just explode on their faces. And once his father, this Homer's father, gets really mad at him and says, if I see you with these stupid rockets again anywhere in the neighborhood, right, I'm going to ground you, right? He threatens him of their consequences. So these boys didn't want to give up their dream. So they move away and create a small launch pad far from the village, about 8 miles from the village, and continue their experiments. But the experiments keep on failing. But they keep on improving their rocket design by learning from their failures. And at the end of the whole movie, at the end of this long effort or long series of failures, they were successful in building an excellent rocket. The rocket goes up in the air and goes beyond the clouds, goes up several kilometers into the atmosphere. It was a big hit. And that project gets them a first prize in the National Science Fair. So this story was made into a movie called October Sky, because this all this happened in October, and the first happened in October. Right? October Sky also happens to be an anagram. That is, if you jumble the letters in the words October Sky, it becomes Rocket Boys, and that's what they are, they're Rocket Boys. So this story was made into a movie, and I recommend you watch this film. It's a great movie, very inspiring movie. I saw this movie many times, and I used to find it very inspiring. Okay, so that's the power of a mastermind group. Please try to form such a group among yourselves, among your friends and classmates. Then the third category of people is you need to have a team who works for you, right, who works under your guidance, right? Because again, one person cannot do much. It's a group that can do a lot. And teams are very effective. Teams are very powerful. So about teams, let me quote from Gene Wilkes. He says teams are much greater than individuals because, right, when there's a team, there are more ideas, there's more energy. People can motivate each other. When somebody is feeling down, others can motivate, and they all grow together. And teams can maximize leader's potential. Leader can have many ideas, lots of enthusiasm, but one person cannot do much. You need to have a team where each person does something specific. When there's a team, there can be multiple perspectives. So each person looks at the problem in a different angle, which may be necessary, because one person may not be able to look at the problem in all different angles. So when there is victory, they all share it, and then there's even greater joy of celebration. And when there's a defeat, again, they all share that pain, and so there's lesser pain for individuals. Right, and leaders are made accountable, there's a team, and so on. So a lot of benefits of having a team, so try to create a team. Coming to team building or team creation, because that's one of the things that a leader does. The leader creates a great team by inspiring them and by deciding who will do what. The team, the leader brings together a bunch of people and creates a great team. A good example of team building is the movie Lagan. It's a fictional story, but it's a great example of team building. If you haven't watched it, watch it. I heard somewhere that even in IIMs, they show this movie Lagan as an example of a great exercise in team building. Okay, so the finally, so we talked about how to work with others. Then let us talk about other domains of life that are equally important. So we talked about mainly about career until now. But for you, for a person to have a great career, you need to have, you need to attend to and take care of other divisions of life also. You cannot ignore other parts of life. The life is a whole. And you cannot separate career from life. So to illustrate this, let me give a small story. It was described by Stephen Covey in his book. So in this story, there's this guy who is trying to cut a piece of log using his saw. So he was sawing it for a long time, continuously, without taking any rest. And somebody observes that and notices that the saw has become blunted. The teeth have become blunt. So it's taking a very long time to cut the log. So somebody says, hey, why don't you stop your process for a little while, right? Step aside and sharpen the saw and come back and continue the cutting. But this man says, no, I can't do that. I can't afford to do that because I'm already running late and I have to finish this quickly and by working harder. And that's exactly the mistake that we do very often in life. Because if you sharpen the saw for take a small break and sharpen the saw and come back, the process will go faster. Right? What is the relevance of this to our career? So you are the instrument, right, with which you do the work in your career and you're trying to further your career. But if you keep on working without any break, then the instrument becomes blunt, right? Whereas a better policy would be to take a break, sharpen the instrument, that's yourselves, right? And then go back to work. So that is what is called work-life balance, right? Work is as important as relaxation or what you do outside your job. The many things you can do outside your job, you have to go outside your job. So relax properly, or you know, do meditation, or you know, get into some sports or healthy exercise. Spend time with family, which is very important, right? And etc. etc. There's a lot of things that you have to do to balance your work life with what you do outside your workplace. Family is extremely important because family is like a fortress from which you fight the battles of life. Life can be very challenging sometimes, and so family is your protection, right? So we need to really create a harmonious and strong family. But that doesn't happen automatically. Just because you have family and you have some good relationships, it's not automatic that there'll be harmony among the family members, right? So you have to do a lot of work, you have invest time, and then create strong bonding within the family members by supporting and nurturing each other. Let me give an example. There's this man who's an engineer, and his wife likes to be a writer. She writes books. But his man doesn't like what his wife does, because he thinks writing books is not a great thing. But wife likes that activity. And obviously, writers are important for society, and they need books. But the husband doesn't understand that. Therefore, there's some friction between the husband and the wife. Similarly, the daughter likes to become a doctor, let us say. Whereas husband thinks that daughter should become an engineer like him. So he keeps on putting pressure on daughter to become an engineer, right? So if you look at a family like this, you can easily imagine what kind of friction and unhappiness that can be there in the family like that. Whereas if each person in the family understands the goals and aspirations of other people in the family and help them, achieve those goals and attain those dreams, then there'll be a greater bonding among the family members, right? And once the family becomes strong in a healthy way like that, not because, right, usually what happens is there is a kind of the male member of the family is totally dominating and tells everybody what to do, and everybody has to obey them. Otherwise, there'll be, pressure and unhappiness and all that. But whereas if each person is more understanding of others' goals and say supportive of the others' goals, there'll be a more natural bonding and love and affection in the family. And such a family can be of great help in career. And the careers of all the members of the family can really flourish if there is a kind of a love and bonding in the family. Next, health is very important, right? Because whatever you want to have to do in life, you cannot do without having health. And since you're all young, you're students, health is natural to you, it comes automatically, so you may even take it for granted, right? But if you don't have healthy habits at this age, once you enter your 30s and 40s and slowly problems start dropping out, and that might be too late and to worry about health at that time. A simple formula for somebody at your age is get into some sports activity. And sports are fun. I mean, for you, since you're youngster, sports are fun. And I know one family member, a relative of mine, he's right now 85 years old, is still very healthy, fit as a fiddle. And what is the secret of health? Very simple. He has been a tennis player all his life. He's not a professional player or anything. He used to play tennis regularly all his life, about 3-4 times a week, right? And that's the simple secret of success, the secret of health, right? And that's something a lot of, pretty much everybody among you can do that. And in some cases, you know, some medical insurance companies, they do this. They create pictures of a given individual about showing them how they will look when they are old. Right, because normally we think that we'll be healthy like this all our lives. That may not happen, obviously. Right, so this health insurance people play this trick. They create mock pictures of individuals to show how they look when they're old, so that they'll be encouraged to buy some insurance. Point is, whether we buy insurance or not, that's a different matter. Right, if we can visualize ourselves how we will be when we are 50 or 60 or 70, that will motivate us to take the right action in the present when we are still young. Then money. Money is obviously important. I mean, we all know that. But I'm not going to tell you about how to make money in the sense of how to. You need to talk to a financial planner. And it's important to understand that even at a young age, right? What are stocks, what are mutual funds, all that. I mean, we are, and by and large, an average Indian can be quite ignorant. I myself was very ignorant until for a long time. So it's good to talk to a financial planner and get some financial knowledge, right, even at a very young age. But I'll talk about a couple of attitudes that a lot of us have about money. Some of them are negative attitudes. Like, for example, a lot of people think that money is root of all evil. That obviously is a negative attitude. And that's the kind of attitude that keep money away from you. If you think money is bad, it won't come to you. Right? People say, don't hanker for money. If you're rich, you're bad. Some people think that all rich people are bad people. Which is obviously wrong, but these are the kinds of attitudes which will keep money away, right? And rich people become rich by looting poor. And that's also not true, because if rich people become rich by looting poor, then the total money in a given nation should be constant, should be a fixed amount. And that's not true, obviously. Look at India's GDP, right? It keeps on growing every year, every decade, right? Which means that it's not a conservation of mass. Right? Money will grow, is generated by creative and diligent effort of people in that nation. Right? So, and also if you serve others, right, if you fulfill a social need, money will automatically come to you. Thing is, if you can identify your talent, identify a social need, and find that match. Okay, here is a need, here I have a talent, and with this talent I can fulfill a social requirement, then that will give you money, that will fetch you money. So find out the talent that will help you serve the society. So I would like to quote a very important quotation here by William James, who was an American psychologist of the 19th century. He says, the greatest discovery of our generation is that human beings can alter their lives by altering their attitudes of mind. Thing is, attitudes are very important. If you have negative attitudes about your life, pessimistic and defeatist attitudes, your life will actually be like that. If you have develop more positive attitudes, hopeful attitudes, right, attitudes that are motivating, inspiring, and helpful, then to that extent, life will change positively. So I would recommend you to read. If you watch this movie called The Founder, it's a story of the man who started the McDonald's chain of restaurants. I'm sure everybody knows McDonald's. How was this chain of restaurants started? It was started by a guy called Ray Kroc. And Ray Kroc was initially a salesman. He used to go from door to door and sell some equipment. But he got bored with that life. And he used to listen to these motivational lectures. And one of the ideas that these lectures repeatedly emphasize is this. That is, you change your attitudes from negative to positive attitudes. That will slowly have a transformational effect on your life. So you watch this movie, if you can get hold of it, it's a very motivating movie. So finally, so I talked to you about some of these qualities of successful people and how they work and how they work with others and so on, and how they, what are the different divisions of life outside your career. And so there's a lot of books which talk about these things. There's a, actually there's something like a science of success, right, which talk about all these ideas. And you can read them, a lot of books out there, you can read them on the net, right, and they can be very motivating. They can help you in your career efforts and bring you success, right? And then once you're successful, you know, try to give back to the society, right? Because it's with the help of society that we all become successful. Nobody becomes successful sitting in a forest in the middle of nowhere, right? By working with society in a certain positive fashion, we ourselves grow. So we have an obligation to give back to the society. So in that context, I would like to quote this idea called the American Dream. Say the 60s and 70s, a lot of Indians, like, you know, went to the US, to America, and settled down. Even though a lot of people go to India, but a lot of people are also coming back from US to India. So because in the 60s, 70s, there were not many jobs in India, so whereas America was flourishing, and so people used to go to the US in search of what is called the American Dream. What is American Dream? It is defined like this. Life should be better and richer and fuller for everybody, with opportunity for each according to the ability or achievement, regardless of social class or circumstances of birth. This is what is called American Dream. American society, American system offers this kind of an equal opportunity for everybody. So it doesn't matter what your background is, religion is, or class is. If you have the talent, if you are hardworking, it will give you the opportunity to progress and grow equally. This is the ideal of an American Dream. Now, if you look at the way things are happening in the US, especially the last decade, that is the decade of 2010 to 2020, things have been changing very rapidly. It's really, this is becoming very hard to keep track of the variety of changes that are happening in India. Now, we are becoming like, you know, this, so the what was described as American Dream, you can easily describe it as an Indian dream in the Indian society today. Right, that life should be better and richer and fuller for everyone, regardless of their background and social class and all that. Right, so if we use the success principles and if we grow, each of us, if we grow like this, then India will, sure, I'm sure it will become like this, glorious India with a lot of wealth and happiness. Now cities might transform finally, you know, from their current state of filth and squalor into something beautiful and glorious like this. Right, so Jai Hind, I just want to also mention that we have designed this new script called Bharati, which is a common script for all the Indian languages. You can write any Indian language in this simple script. It's very easy to learn. It takes just 15 minutes to learn. So we have a website called bharatiscript.com. Take a look at it when you have time. So with that, I stop, and if you have any questions, I can take questions. Jai Hind.
Participants, please ask doubts.
Or you can ask questions in the chat box.
Sir, already there are some comments in the chat box. You can please see. There are some comments already in the chat box.
There's only one question I can see.
In the current scenario, it's like a comment.
Fatima, the current scenario, they are taking huge risk and trying to get rid of risk. I don't understand. Can somebody explain that? Fatima, can you explain that question? What is the question there?
No, actually, whatever points you are telling, okay, let me tell. I think maybe she is unable to listen to you, or maybe unable to respond immediately because they may be watching in mobile, no? Let me read that. In current scenario, like whatever you are referring, she is just quoting in current scenario, they are talking, they are taking huge risk on trying to get rid of risk or minimize the risk in order to achieve target. Okay, so some people will try to minimize the risk. That's what he is trying to reflect upon. When you said, no, like people, they take risk and try to go out of the way.
What is the question? Okay, so let us wait for
question. She's reflecting on what you are saying. She is saying actually like people, some people are trying to avoid taking risk, or they are trying to minimize the risk. Yeah, that is also good. No, like minimizing the risk. Like we should take risk, but at the same time, we should minimize the risk. That's what she is reflecting. She is adding a point to your word.
Fine, question.
Okay. Yeah, Nikhil Nitya, she is asking some question.
Vikram, it's okay. Let me talk to you. Yes. Nikhil, go ahead. Please ask your question. Nikhil, do you have any question? Hello. Nikhil, can you unmute yourself and ask the question? Hello. Okay, anybody else? You can type your question in the chat box, or you can ask a question orally, but you have to unmute yourself.
Hello, good afternoon, sir. Chakravarti, yeah, sir. I'm Mohammad Abdul Bari. I'm one of the members of the staff. May I ask two questions, sir?
Yeah, please go ahead.
A very good afternoon to you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
In fact, I am immensely pleased with your profound knowledge and the way you dealt with the topic I rise and I help rise others. But I feel that examples cited are more from abroad and also from movies.
Yeah.
I think you could also have cited the real experience of those Indians who came up in real life through sheer hard work and their, I mean, you could have also quoted some famous quotes of those people.
Yes,
do you say in this regard? And then the next question is, I agree with you and many others, and in general too, that hard work leads to success. And when we talk about success, we also talk more about attitudes, especially positive.
Yeah.
Then how come this doctrine came into being that you can take a horse to the pond, but you cannot make it drink? With this, should we not accept this is also true?
Yeah. Okay, so let me answer, try to address your question one by one.
Okay, sir.
But your first question is quite valid, and I'm sorry about it. I'll slowly change the examples. Because what is happening is this whole success literature is an echo for some reason. Okay, so success literature is very popular in US. It is coming to India also, but it's very popular in US, and I have most of my books are written by Americans, right? So I've been taking examples from there, but I'm sure there are a lot of examples obviously in India. I just have to collect them, so I'll do that and slowly substitute the examples with Indian examples. I'll do that. I really apologize for that. The second question you asked, what was that?
It is about success, sir.
Yeah.
In general, we know that hard work leads to success. And when we talk about success, we also talk more about attitudes, especially positive. And how come this doctrine came into being that you can take a horse to the pond, but you can't make it drink? This, should we not accept this also?
Okay. So let me try to clarify that. So first of all, when you talk about, when you say that hard work brings success, usually we talk about hard work, but first of all, what is your goal, right? Is it a goal that you have chosen yourself, or is it something that that you're doing because of pressure from a lot of experts? Sir, can you please mute yourself for a moment? Hello, Can you please mute yourself for a moment? Yeah, thank you. So thing is, when you talk about hard work, Are you putting in the hard work? So take, for example, students like, right, they have to put in hard work to pass an exam. But that hard work is a more mechanical thing because somebody else is telling you that, you know, you have to do this and do this and all that. But if it's a goal that you have chosen yourself, consciously, willingly, then you will put in the effort that is required. You will do what it takes, right? That's what is meant by taking horse, and you can take the horse up to the lake. The parents can push the student up to a point, but only up to a point, not beyond. But if the student or the individual takes up a goal all by himself or herself, consciously, then they'll do whatever it takes to get there. So there's no need to, then in that case, there's no need to, you know, this horse quotation doesn't apply. It applies only when somebody is pushing you, and also if your goal is a self-chosen goal, hard work doesn't seem like hard work because it's voluntary and it can be, it'll be enjoyable. You won't even notice that you're working very hard. So all that I'm saying is shift the focus from somebody else telling you what to do and what is good for you to yourself, right, realizing what is good for you and working with that realization. Then things will be totally different. I hope that answer is kind of satisfactory. There is an important difference.
Thank you very much, sir. In fact, the question which I asked was from examination point of view and then the student's point of view. Thank you very much. The effort is from us for others. Yeah. It is not for ourselves. Yeah. Thank you very much, sir, for answering this question.
Thank you, sir. So, Nikhil, somebody else says, Nikhil. Hello.
Sir, may I ask a question?
Yeah, please, go ahead. Yeah.
Sir, what is the main use of Bharati script, sir?
See, in India, we have so many languages and so many scripts, right? Communication becomes a problem, especially when you go to a new state. Thing is, the two sides of language, one is the spoken language and another is written form. Now, in India, every language has practically its own script. So that makes communication even harder. So the question, even though you have multiplicity of languages, and we have a single script, and that's quite possible because if you look at Western Europe, there are many nations, they all have different languages, but they all have pretty much the same script, like, you know, English, German, French, Portuguese. They're all different languages, but they all have the same script. So that makes the communication somewhat easier in Europe. So like that, in India also, can we have a common script even though we cannot have a common language? It's, I mean, language is more difficult to say. With that thinking, we started this new script. It's a very simple script to learn because script can be very hard to learn. For example, if you, let's say, you know, like the Urdu script or a Hindi script or something. If you have to learn, let's say, Oriya script, right, it's very challenging. Whereas Bharati takes about 15 minutes. It's a very simple script. That's all. It's just a creation. If people are interested, they can learn. Okay.
Yeah, thank you, sir. My question was cleared. Sir, can you give a small example? Like, my name is Hamza. So, can you give some small example by that script, by naming my name?
Let me see. Okay. Actually, what we will do, we'll have a separate program on Bharati sometime, if you're interested. Vikram, you know, goes around giving, you know, doing these kind of programs in schools, right? If your college is interested, we'll have a talk on that. And we'll show you how to write this thing. But for the moment, you can, because I cannot write on the screen. Right? Oh, wait a minute. Let me just one second. Okay, I opened the paint. Can you see the paint application?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so you can see my pen, right? Za. Right, I'm sorry, this should be, is Hamza, right?
Yes, sir.
That is Hamza.
H-A-M-Z-A.
Yeah. That's how, this is how you write Hamza in Bharati. Right. If you want to write Vikram, this is why we So it's very simple. You can take a look at the website, and if you guys are interested, we'll have a separate lecture on that. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you. It was great.
Thank you. Then Nikhil, you have a question. Or anybody else? Anybody else? So, if there are no questions, shall we wind up?
Yeah, okay, sir. So, sir, HOD, sir, can you give a vote of thanks, like some representative of the college?
That was an amazing teaching on science of success, sir. Now I would like to thank our chief patron, Shah Alam Rasul Khan, sir. Today's patron, our dear principal, Dr. Atikur Rahman, sir, and Professor S.A. Munim, sir, and Dr. B. Srinivas, sir. Thank you, Dr. R. Jyoti Kumar, sir, Dr. Ilya, sir, Dr. Nasib Khan, sir, and Dr. Sheikh Saidul sir for arranging this opportunity for all of us. And a special thanks to Vikram sir for providing us this opportunity and making things smoother for all of us. And finally, special thanks to Professor V. Srinivasa Chakravarti sir for sharing such motivational and learn-worthy stories with us. All of us are so happy to have you here, and definitely we had learned a lot today. And thank you to all the participants for enjoying the lecture. I hope everyone had a good time here and learned something. Please have a good day ahead. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot, and good luck for everyone.
Thanks a lot for all the participants. So we will send the feedback link to the all the registered participants. Already you have registered, no? So we will send the feedback link in that. You can please fill it out. It will also have some questions based on the talk's content, okay? Whatever sir was discussing, okay? So there will be some questions based on that. So you will be able to easily write it and reinforce all the points which were discussed in the class, okay? Thanks a lot. We are planning some more programs with some ISRO scientists, DRDO scientists. So show the enthusiasm like this and try to attend those programs also and get benefited by them. Thanks a lot. Dhanyavad. And I would like to thank the HOD and also Saidulu sir for taking all the interest and giving the information to the students on time and seeing that many people attend this and get benefited by this. Thanks a lot to all the volunteers, student volunteers and coordinators. And thanks to Sandeep ji for providing this online platform. Okay. He is a PhD scholar from IIT Madras. Thank you.